And I would like to introduce a bit concentration inequalities for dynamical systems. So at the beginning, I will use this wonderful beamer, and then I will switch to the blackboard. So it will make a little pause. And so my goal is to start with the simplest possible example of the concentration of measure phenomenon. In a very simple example, and then to go to dynamical systems and to show how it translates and all the consequences you can have. So yes, so this is this way, no, this way. So let me start with a toy model, which is the simplest random walk you can imagine. So you start at zero on Z. And so you add the pluses and minuses with the same probability. So of course, this is the position of your random walker is centered on average. So the xi's are independent. And there is a famous inequality by Chernoff, which is was proved in the last century, which is the following. If you look at the distance that you have made, you have performed after n steps, then the probability that this distance is larger than some u is less than this quantity. So it's exponential of minus u squared divided by n. And this is valid for any n and for any u, strictly positive. Of course, I will not discuss anymore this kind of those things later on. If u is very big, bigger than square, of order n, this doesn't make any sense, okay? Because this probability will be zero. Okay, so I think each time it's evident where is the right range, but anyway. And so maybe the best way to look at this inequality is to look at two different scales, which are very natural. The one I call a large deviation scale, which is the scale of the law of large numbers. And there is another very natural scale, which is the central limit theorem. So let me do this. If you start, you see, since this is valid for any, since this is valid for any u and any n, I can just take u as I want. And here I just replace, I just set u equal to Sn. And if you do that, you see that the probability that the absolute value of Sn bigger than S times n is exponentially small in n. And still you have this, A square over two, it doesn't matter, the two. And so if you want to compare with large deviations that many of you know, I don't know exactly. In large deviation theory, you can prove first in this very simple example, a bound, which is of this sort. This is, you take the same quantity, so forget about the absolute value, it just removes the two. This is less than exponential of minus n, so the same decay in n, times a certain function that I will not write down, which is an entropy function. And the goal of large deviation theory is to compute the exact exponential decay rate. So if you take the logarithm, divide by n, and take the limit, you can prove that in this example, which is elementary, that you get exactly minus I of s. And if you plot you know, this red function, we compare it to this just this function, this quadratic function, you say that it is more or less the same, around zero. And so the goal of large deviations is really about getting this kind of result. Whereas here, you just wonder about what happens when n is finite, okay? So this is the first remark. But clearly, there is a common departure between large deviations and concentration inequalities. Next, the next scale, it's the scale of the central limit theorem. So if I write again a Chernoff bound here, it's exactly the same as the first page. Now instead of taking u equal to Sn, I put u equal to t square root of n. And you see immediately the effects, this cancels this n, and you get the probability that you are away from zero, which is the average position, remember, by a multiple of square root of n is extremely small. Okay? Since here you see this gets extremely small if t is already, I don't know, 10. And so, of course, this is really of Gaussian flavor, it's clear. And to be more precise, let me just have a look at the Gaussian paradise, where everybody would like to live, but unfortunately we not live in this paradise. So let me take for just 1 minute Z1, Zn independent Gaussian random variables, which are centered and with a variance equal to 1. So Sn is just the sum. So everybody knows that Sn divided by square root of n has exactly the same law as one of them. And so now you have a classical sandwich bound, which tells you the following. If since this is Gaussian, you can estimate the tails. And the probability that so this absolute value of Sn is bigger than u times square root of n is less than this. You have a 1 over u, but which is not very relevant, okay, because it decays really slowly in comparison with this guy. And you have also a lower bound, which is of course interesting if u is larger than 1, but doesn't matter. And you see you have the same behavior also for the lower bound. So in some sense, if you forget about this prefactor, this is really the best behavior you can imagine, okay? So this is, but let's go out of this paradise. And now, if I summarize what I've just done in a very roughly, but I think it's a right way to state it without formula. If you come back to my random walk example, you see that the distance that the random walk have performed after n steps is a priori of order n, okay? Because this can be as big as n. But with very high probability, in fact, you are concentrated in an interval of width square root of n. And of course, Sn, it's a function of my x1, xn, which is simply a sum. And you see it's a very simple linear function of my random variables. And now the question I ask myself, and of course it was asked by many people before me, it's what happens when you ask two things to be completely different. First, you replace f, this f, which is a simple sum, by a nonlinear function. So what I'm asking is this phenomenon have something to do with the fact that you have a linear function of your xi? The answer is no, as we will see. Of course, we'll have to assume some smoothness of f, but otherwise f can be very wide. And of course, it's not very exciting to stay in the world of independent random variables. So I ask what happens for dependent random variables. And we want to explore this kind of behavior, in particular get this kind of bound, when you don't have any more independent random variables, and you get, instead of putting just this simple function, take an arbitrary nonlinear function of x1, xn, okay? This is the goal. And today, of course, people thought about this for, even for independent random variables, this is a relevant question. I will not explain why people are interested in nonlinear functions. I will give examples later on. And of course, people started to think about Markov chains and other mixing processes. Okay, so today I will only speak about random variables generated by dynamical systems, chaotic dynamical systems. And let me stress a point: is that a key point? Even if it is clear, I want to stress it. We are really interested in inequalities which are valid for all n, and we don't look for limit theorems. Okay, so this is as we will see. We want to get some inequalities which are valid for all deviation values and all n, and all time n. So, just to fix notations, now I turn to dynamical systems. T will be my map from omega to omega, and I will assume that I have a T invariant ergodic probability measure mu. And an n orbit of a point is this thing, of course. And now if you draw x according to this probability measure mu, you get some realization of a stationary stochastic process. And in fact, if you want to write down the finite dimensional marginals of this process, it's simply what you expect. You see, you start, the randomness is concentrated on the starting point, which is distributed according to mu. And then, you, of course, it's the deterministic dynamical system, you have a product of Dirac measures. Okay? So, see, just to make a bridge with stochastic processes. And of course, there is the basic result is the ergodic theorem. So, if you take a nice observable, if you take the Birkhoff average, it converges mu almost surely to the integral of f respect to mu. And of course, now if you're interested in understanding the fluctuations of this Birkhoff average, you need more assumptions. And I will discuss a class of dynamical systems today for which you can say nice results about these kind of things. And I will show how you can prove the concentration inequality. This is my goal. So what is this class? This class is it's a very, very well-known class called dynamical systems modeled by Young Towers with exponentially decaying return time tails. So I will not give the formal definition. I will give a bunch of examples in a minute instead of putting abstract definitions. So for this class of systems, you have a nice measure, an SRV measure, which is unique under some general assumptions. If you look at the correlation coefficient, so the autocovariance of F, so this is the usual way to measure the mixing properties of the system. If you take F Lipschitz, then this, in this class, this decay is exponentially fast. You can prove a central mid theorem. So I don't have time to explain, but you can imagine what it is. And then you have also a large deviation principle. So in the same spirit as I explained in my little example, you can compute the probability of large deviations in the sense of logarithmic equivalence. And the next item I want to add today is this kind of dynamical system satisfy a Gaussian concentration bound. So this is my goal. And just to give a few examples, if you don't know this class, I will start with the simplest one and increase the complexity. So for instance, you have, if you take the interval 0, 1 and take the 2x modulo 1, mu is just Lebesgue measure. If you complicate a bit more, if you have a piecewise C2 expanding map on the unit interval, which looks like that, then you we know for a long time that there is a unique, absolutely continuous invariant measure with respect to Lebesgue. And it has good mixing properties. If you now you consider, the, for instance, the logistic map for the set of parameters which has Lebesgue measure strictly positive, you get also this kind of good properties. So this is, these are one-dimensional examples. You have also axiom A attractors. You have also the Enon attractor for good parameters in the sense of Benedict-Carlson. All these examples fit the class I just mentioned before. And now, as I promised, I have to speak about what is my F, big F. You remember, I asked myself, what kind of F do I want to put? And this is maybe I put the definition on the blackboard. So I was just separately Lipschitz. So if I have F from omega n to r, I want that when I only change the ith variable, this is less than some number lib I of f times the distance. So I have a distance in my dynamical system, of course. And I want this to, you know, if I change everything except everything, yes, I take the worst case. You know, you can move x naught, xi minus 1, etc. And then you take also the worst case if this guy is different from this guy. You want this, and of course, I want this to be finite, okay? For all I So this is the only condition I will ask for my, my functions. Okay? And so the simplest example, just to have the most basic example to have in mind, of course I will go away from that, is just to take a Birkhoff sum of a Lipschitz function of, you know, from omega to r. So of course, when you do that, you get exactly for each I the Lipschitz constant of f. Okay, but it's in, just to check the definition. But otherwise, I will state a theorem where here this is the only condition I will ask. F can be very ugly or whatever you want. If you can estimate that these guys, it will be okay. So here is a theorem. So I will write it also here for later purposes. So let me take a dynamical system as I mentioned before, so modeled by a Young Tower with exponentially decaying return time tails. So you take any of the previous examples, for instance. So mu, recall that mu is the RSRB measure. Then you have the following. There exists C, a constant, such that for all n, for all separately Lipschitz function f from omega n to r, we have the following inequality. So if you integrate d mu x against d mu x, you take f along n orbit. You subtract the expected value. Right? This is less than exponential constant, the constant C, times the sum of the square of the Lipschitz coefficient. So this is the inequality. And of course, the crucial point in this inequality is that C is independent of N and F. So C depends only on omega and T. And so if you think a little bit, this is a very strong inequality, because this is given by your initial data, your systems, and then it works whatever N is and whatever F is in this class. Okay. And just another remark, we will see in an example why I say this. You see, a priori, this kind of inequality can only tells you about f minus its expected value. If you think a little bit, if you don't put that, there would be some strange problem. So a priori, you don't know nothing about this guy thanks to this kind of inequalities. Okay, so this is a well-known problem in statistics, where usually you control the fluctuations, but not necessarily the expected value of your estimator. And so there is an almost immediate consequence to this inequality, which is this one. So you just use a Markov inequality and or what is called exponential Tibichev or whatever. So this implies that if you take the measure of points such that f t1 of x minus its expected value is bigger than some u, this is less than 2 exponential minus u square over 4c, the same c as before. There is a piano here. And so you get this kind of deviation inequality around the fluctuations around that. And of course, the two is just because I put absolute values. If you remove absolute values, there is no two. And so it has exactly the same flavor as what we have done at the beginning. But now, of course, we have a dynamical system, which is much more complicated than just a random walk. And we have non-linear functions instead of just the sum of... So here, if you take the Birkhoff sum, of course, it's very easy to see that if you rescale properly, so let me write it here, if you take f x, just to keep this example in mind, the Birkhoff sum, what you get if you renormalize, you see Sn over n minus the integral of f with respect to d mu will be just e to the minus n u squared divided by some constant. Because here you have n times 1 over n squared, and then you just play with the, you can rescale that, so I will not write it. So it gives exactly the same kind of bound with different constants, of course, than the random walk. Okay? So now, you can ask yourself, what is the purpose of getting this kind of inequalities? Why you, I bother you with complicated functions? So let me give a bunch of applications. I will just show one in detail just after this slide. So just, it's a list, of course, so I will not detail everything. So you can apply this to get, for instance, the speed of convergence of the empirical measure towards mu in Cantor orbit distance. Yes?
Can I ask you, how do you prove?
I will prove afterwards. Okay. Then what is called measure concentration. You have, if you are in a case where it makes sense to, you have a density in one dimension, for instance, you can construct a kernel density estimator. There is also an instance of a limit theorem you can get from this inequality. It's just because usually I hear the critique that, okay, but it's just valid for n finite, so you cannot get any limiting results. Of course, it's not true. If you have a good bound and you can use Borel-Cantelli-like arguments, there is an empirical periodogram, if there are physicists in the audience, empirical entropy, and so on and so forth. So there are plenty of applications. And I would like just to show one example, which a concrete example. I don't have much time to discuss it in detail, but I can show you the bound in action, which is some kind of shadowing property. Well, of course, this is not shadowing in the usual sense of hyperbolic numerical systems. I don't claim that, but you'll see the idea. So if I make a little picture, you have your omega space. You take a subset of omega. Of course, I take it with a strictly positive measure, say 1/3. And then to play a game, I start inside this subset A, and I try to imitate orbits which start off A. So here I have my orbit, and I build this quantity. I take the smallest distance between the iterates, because I minimize over y in A. And you see I take my distance and I compare, and I just divide by n. So in fact here, just to simplify a bit, I'm assuming the diameter of omega is 1. Because it's not important for what I want to say. And now the question is, you see this is not something which is linear, because you have an optimization problem to solve, and in general you can't solve this, of course. And this is typical of many applications where you get some quantity which is defined by an optimization problem, and you don't know anything explicitly, I mean. And so it's easy to, I will show you in a minute, to get this theorem as a consequence of this, this and this. So if you take any positive u, any n, you look when this quantity, which is between 0 and 1, okay? If you are x is in A, it's 0, otherwise it's something of order 1 over n. The probability that you are bigger than one constant divided by square root of n is extremely small. I don't have the time to discuss all the consequences of that, but you see it's a kind of... it's saying if you take even a subset with measure 1/3, if you take points only inside that one, you can more or less imitate in this probabilistic sense any orbit of your system. And so it has consequences in multifractal analysis and other things, but I will not discuss it. So let me show you the proof, which is easy. Thank you. So let me do it here. So can you see the blackboard? It's okay?
No.
So it depends of your yes, there are privileged people. So the idea, you see, is to take define an F, which is this guy, which is 1 over n. And here I take the distance between xi and ti of y. So this is a function of n variables, okay? Now, of course, if you take, you evaluate it along n orbit, you get exactly sa xn. And it's an exercise, and it's easy to convince oneself that this is the Lipschitz constant. The worst case is when it's 1 over n. Okay? And now you apply this so without the absolute value, so you can remove the 2. You get that mu x, just applying that, bigger than its expected value, plus, so I already rescaled, so it's easy to see what I've done. I'm just rescaling u in this inequality. This is less than e to the minus u square over 4c. Okay, and this is for any u, any n. Okay? So now, I'm almost happy, but not completely happy, because you see that I'm not interested in SA minus its expected value, but I'm interested in SA itself. So can you bound, find an upper bound for this integral of SA? And it's fun because in this example, you can use again concentration to get a bound. So let's upper bound for this. So I do it. It's just the following trick. You can write that the measure of A is just the integral of exponential minus lambda SA xn times the indicator of the set. And this is lambda is some arbitrary positive number. Okay? You see, if you are outside A, this is zero. And if you are inside A, so this is one, this is zero, so this is exactly mu of A. So now I can just throw away the indicator function, because in fact it doesn't help a lot for the bound. Okay, and now what I do is I want to apply this inequality there. So I apply it. So I put a star just to say that I use this. And if I use this, what you see, you get the exponential of minus lambda SA mu, because you know, you have a minus sign and there is a minus sign there and it becomes a plus, and when you put it on the other side, it would get a minus, times exponential, so it's C lambda squared over N. Okay? Because it's N times 1 over N squared. Because of lib IF is 1 over N. And so now you can just take the log and divide by lambda, which is strictly positive, and so you get that the integral of SA n d mu is less than C lambda over n plus 1 over lambda logarithm of mu a to the power minus 1. Just because I take the log and divide by lambda. And now you can optimize over lambda. And you get, you see this increase, this decreases. So it's when the two terms are equal. And so it's twice the C ln of mu a square minus 1 over n and square root. And I'm finished because, you know, if I put this there, so if I upper bound the integral of SA, so I decrease the probability, so I get the bound the bound I wanted. Yeah. Okay. So this is an example where you can fortunately also estimate the expected value. So you have to switch off this, please. Yes?
Okay, cool.
Thank you. Fantastic, thank you. So let can what can it can use these fantastic blackboards. So how much time do you have still? Just to know, because I you are the chairman and I'm already lost in time, so
24 minutes.
24 minutes, okay, I buy it. So now my goal is, I don't know if I will succeed, but I will try to give the proof of this inequality, not in this in the case of Young Towers, but in the case of a full shift with the Lipschitz potential and with the finite alphabet. And but in fact, the proof is very similar to the proof for Young Towers, up to some tricks. There is no big difference, in fact. Of course, you have to know what is a Young Tower with exponentially decaying return time. But otherwise, if you look at the paper someday, you will see that most of the proof is already clear from this case. Let me try to do it. Yes, this was the. This is almost, I don't have time to speak about that, but I can answer that afterwards if you want. So my goal is to try to prove this theorem in 23 minutes. So maybe I will completely fail, so I'm sorry in advance. So proof. So when I take the following situation, mu is a Gibbs measure. For a Lipschitz potential, on a to the n, and a is finite. And I don't define the distance, this is your usual distance, I will use it later explicitly. And of course, t is the shift. So this is omega, of course, my omega, this is a to the n. And the first observation is that you see we're interested in functions from omega n to r. And I want to consider this as a function on omega to the n. And simply, I just want to say that it depends only on the first n points. And a way to do that is to just say that e pi of f will be zero for if you have a greater than n. Okay? So in some sense, it's locally constant on omega to the power n. Okay? So I really take a function of n points. Each point is in omega, huh? Okay? Not in the alphabet. So now, I will start with the usual way you prove this kind of inequality, which is very classical in probability theory, is to use martingales. So you define FP to be the sigma algebra of events depending only on future coordinates. So it's xi, I greater than p. And this is a decreasing sequence of sigma fields, okay? So in probability, usually people like to go backward because they are pessimistic. They like to look at the past. And in dynamical systems, we look forward. So we look always at the future. So. And so that's why we get, you look and more in the future and you have less and less coordinates and you decrease your information, okay? And I will not write it down, but on this space, you can really take, the measure I defined a while ago, which was mu on the initial condition, then the product of Dirac measures on orbits. And you can take the limit and it defines the measure on this space. Okay. Okay, so now the first step, as I told, is really the classical one, except that we use backward martingales, but it is decreasing, but it's exactly the same idea. So the idea is to write, to define this object, Fp, to be the expected value of F with respect to Fp. To introduce dp, which will be fp minus fp plus 1. And dp is fp measurable, and you have the probability of martingale differences that if you condition upon fp plus 1, it is you get 0. So it's really a martingale difference sequence. And now we have the identity. This is the sum of the dp. And I will make this a bit more explicit. What I mean by, I know that I can send the blackboard like this with the right speed, which is not the case. So what you do now, so more precisely, just to give, it's because it's important for the SQL. What I mean by this fp, so it depends only on coordinates up after time p, so it's a function of xp, xp plus 1, etc. So if I write it in several ways, I just write again this. XP, XP plus 1, etc. And yet, I can also write it in this way. So I have a function of X naught, XP minus 1. Here I have some small XP, etc. You condition upon XP equal to small XP. And still, the last way to write it is to use the transfer operator. It's not exactly the transfer operator, but you will see in a minute. So this is nothing but you take GP, I will say in a second what it is, over Y. You take FY up to time P minus 1. Let me write it and comment afterwards. And here you take the sum over the pre-images. So you take all the points after iterating p times t, you get exactly xp. And what is g? G is a Jacobian of the inverse Jacobian, of course, is the inverse of the Jacobian of t. And so gk is the same for tk. And here I don't write explicitly, but of course g is nothing but exponential of the potential if you normalize it, okay? So I don't write it because it shows that you can do this in a more general context if you have something like a diffeomorphism. So if phi is my potential, I normalize it in the way we already heard many times today, in such a way that exponential phi, it's really a probability kernel. So in particular, you can see this this G to be a kernel of your Markov chain. You have a Markov chain on omega, and if you are at x at some point time t, a discrete time of course, then the probability to jump to one of the preimages of x which is y, it's exactly g of y, okay? If you have normalized things in a... So this is exactly, we can take this as a definition. So you see, you average on the first piece, the first piece of orbit up to time p with respect to this Jacobian, inverse of the Jacobian. And I can now define the transfer operator that, because I will use it, of course. So transfer operator associated to my potential. So it's AKF of x. So take f to be a continuous function on omega. So this is tk of y is x, and this is gk of y f y. And I will use later on that this, on this nice, in this nice context, you have a spectral gap, of course. Okay? So this is the first step. And now what we want is to control, of course, this dp. And in which way? I will explain now. So second step. There is a lemma, lemma one, there will be two lemma, which tells the following. There exists a C, there exists a rho less than one, depending only on omega t, such that you have the following, if you look at the and if the supremum norm of dp, it is less than a constant times this sum. So I have to be careful with the indices. So this is rho p minus j lip j of f. And I want to say that c is changed from at each line, okay? In this talk, I will not try to keep track of the constant, okay? Because it would be a more complicated story. So C is not the same C as here. At the end, you take the biggest C that appears in your notes, and this is the C. And so, you see, for a moment, assume you have this lemma, assuming lemma one. So that's why I put some... assuming you can finish how you finish, then you can apply this. The first, yes, let me do that. Yes, imagine that you already know that you have proved it. So, what you do, you can use the following fact that if you compute the sum of your dp up to some n for the moment is anything. So it's p, sorry. This is less than e to the minus the sum. Yes, p, put a p, so let's... no, sorry, I'm just going too fast. So this is less than this. It's correct, yes. And this is known as Azuma-Ding inequality. So n is arbitrary. Okay. So this is a well-known inequality, and if I had time, I could prove it quite. I mean, it takes a small blackboard to do it. It's a nice, it's a useful inequality. And as you can see here, the strong thing you ask is to control uniformly that guy. So you see immediately why. It will not work in any dynamical system, of course, even if it is sufficiently mixing, is that you take here the worst case, because you don't take any advantage of the fact that there would be some byte points which have a small probability with respect to mu. Here, on this side, you have no more mu, okay? But this can be fixed, but I will not discuss that today. Once you have that, then you play with this lemma. So you say that if you take this bound, so you don't put the C, of course, it doesn't matter. You take the square of that because you need the square. And this is less, you use Cauchy-Schwarz, the most useful inequalities. Of inequalities, so this is you can separate, take some row square root of O, so it gives that times the sum of these guys, so P minus J. So this is Cauchy-Schwarz. And now you can do it in a so this is, of course, a finite number. You can just put infinity. And this is some constant z. Because rho is smaller than 1, it's positive, of course. And then if now you sum over, so the last point, you see it's to a sum over j. So yes, over p, sorry. So you have this. V P L square. So again, when you, of course, you have to keep that to do the next step. And if you just look at it carefully, it is less than this. You can just even put any sum over all j. Remember that after some j, this is zero. This leap. Okay. And if you want to do it in a more nicer way, you can use a twice Young inequality for convolutions, which is more classy, but I don't do it because otherwise I would need to recall a Young inequality. But if you do it, it's more elegant, but I'm not elegant today. And then the last step, you see, it's very nice because here n is fixed, but it's arbitrary. Here you get something which is a sum over of all j of z squared, and you can take the limit. Because for each n you have that. On the right doesn't depend anymore on n. And you get this inequality. Yes, you are finished because you know you can control. You remember that f minus its expected value, it's exactly the sum of the dp. And I just show that everything is under control. Okay, so this is the first step. Of course, I have to prove lemma one. So let me do it. And so the third step, it's lemma two, which tells you the following. So what is the idea of this lemma? It's very simple, in fact. You want dp to be bounded uniformly. This means that, you know, fp is no far away from fp plus one, otherwise it wouldn't be bounded. And so the idea is to show that fp is indeed close to some integral, to some integral, which is what you expect from your random walk. Remember, you have your Markov chain, and it will homogenize. You get equidistribution in space. So this is exactly what the lemma says. If you compare fp, xp, etc., minus the integral of f, now you see you have xp, etc., and you integrate over y. So you average with respect to mu these guys. Then this is less than, and this is it works for any xp, etc., some constant times the sum leap jf rho p minus 1 minus j. And c is positive. And rho is less than 1. And it also depends only, in fact, c is not the same as before, but rho will be more or less the same. OK, so this is lemma 2. And now, assuming lemma 2, we get lemma 1 at once. Because, you know, when you compare fp minus fp, and you do, you know, let me write it. If you just do that, xp plus 1, and you subtract the same, but you just change the first coordinate, you know, it's bounded by this, in fact. How do you do that? You simply subtract this and add it. Of course, there is a small difference because this point is not this point. And the extra price for this is just leap p of f. And so you really it's really easy to get that this is less than some constant, which is a bit different, but not by more. Of exactly, so this is exactly the same bound. And I go until p because of this, OK? So it's p leap jf rho p minus g. OK, so it's easy. And now you see, if I average over the preimages of that guy, I get exactly fp plus 1, OK? Because it's written over there. No, it's this blackboard. Sorry. You see, fp plus 1, so you take the, you sum with your Jacobian for the preimaging of these guys, and it gives you exactly dp. And so you get exactly the same bound. Okay, for dp. So average, then average over the free images of x, so xp plus 1 of x prime p, okay? And you get the same bound, and so it gives the bound, same bound, for dp, or if you want, you can put the supremum norm, okay? And so now the last step is, of course, to prove lemma 2, and I think I will not have time. So what I can do is just to sketch the proof to see where I boil down to use this property. I mean, the spectral gap that I didn't write yet. So let me do it now. So the fourth step. Lemma 2, and I'm done. If I do that, it's okay. And what is the idea? So let me explain it basically. So the idea is to make further telescoping. So you understood that, I've done a telescoping, which is, as I told, the classical one. And now I have to do the following one. So the idea is to eliminate variables one after the other to make something more amenable. So I write it if it's really just a telescoping, even if it looks complicated, it's not, it is not. So you have TP, Y is XP, it's XP. So you have GP, then you have F of Y, you go up to ti minus 1, y. And then I put some arbitrary points in my space. Then I put xp, and then it's xp plus 1, etc. And I subtract the same. So I forgot some points, sorry. Here I put the same. Here I just put x bar. And if you do that, so this is just to see that here you have this difference. And you have to adopt something which is a constant term, which is used at the end, where x bar in omega is arbitrary. You take whatever point you want. And now, I will not explain, but it's very easy to, if you do it carefully, you can introduce a function of one variable. And now this function is the following. So if you it's ti y gives exactly x your z, then you have the Jacobian. And you have here this kind, the same kind of things here. Ty x bar. Okay. Minus. So the, you know, the same, almost the same, except that I put here x bar. Okay, let me put some brackets like that. And now this is a function of one variable. And what you can check is that fp, so you're what, you remember my fp is my quantity of interest. It is a sum now of my pair of Frobenius operator, my transfer operator, acting on these functions. And you have still this correction. That's it. So now, yes, so now let me just finish, I finish just a comment. So now you are in business because you know how this behaves because you have the spectral graph for your Pirenne Frobenius operator. So the iterates over Lipschitz functions go exponentially fast to the integral with respect to mu. So of course, we have to prove that fi is bounded. And that leap of fi is finite. So you are in this space of Lipschitz functions. And you have to control the Lipschitz norm. And then you are almost done. So I will not do that. This is pretty classical. And when you do that, you just put all everything together. And erase, I don't know what it is hidden there. No, I don't see where is it. And so what you have to do is just to add up all these inequalities. And when you use the spectral gap, you also have the sum of the integrals over I of the integral of fi with respect to mu. And all these cancels. And exactly this is used to exactly recover this term. So I will not do it. And that's it. I think I will stop now. So thank you for your attention.